Welcome to Ring of Fire. I'm Farron Cousins, and here's what's happening tonight. Congresswoman Debbie Wasserman Schultz may soon have to answer for her anti-consumer views as she faces an uphill battle for re-election. We'll have her challenger, Tim Canova, on later in the program to discuss his campaign. And the corporate media is failing its viewers. We'll tell you how you can fight back. That's what's coming up. You've just stepped in to the Ring of Fire.
There's been zero warming, none whatsoever.
I'm running for president of the United States.
Congress declares war, not the president. Start with the countries that are burning our flag.
We regret these errors and apologize.
We apologize.
We apologize.
And apologize.
This is good news, people.
Before we begin tonight, I wanted to take a few minutes to talk about the importance of free speech TV. We're now a few days into our first pledge drive of the year, and this year is unlike any that we've ever faced. We're in the middle of a heated presidential race with a group of radical extremists on the Republican side and a Democratic establishment on the other that wants to move the party further to the right. We have the leader of the Democratic Party, Congresswoman Debbie Wasserman Schultz, the chair of the Democratic National Committee, who wants to work with Republicans to gut financial regulations against the payday lending industry, an industry, by the way, that makes hundreds of millions of dollars preying on low-income Americans. This is coming from the leader of the Democratic Party, and she wants to gut something that Senator Elizabeth Warren put in place to protect consumers. And what about the corporate media? For the last 12 months, MSNBC, the news outlet that conservatives claim is so liberal, has been purging some of their more progressive hosts and personalities. They removed anyone that was willing to challenge the powers that be, and they've put all of their stock in the Trump-supporting Joe Scarborough. The result is that the network has become Fox Light, and they've proven that their corporate masters at Comcast are calling the shots. They're just as beholden to corporations as the leaders of both the Democratic and Republican parties. And the problem is that when you have media outlets owned by corporate interests, every talking point that comes from that network is going to be to the benefit of those corporate interests. But here at Free Speech TV, we do not have advertisers, we do not have shareholders, and we do not filter our stories to spare the feelings of corporate America. Our loyalty is to you, our viewers, and you're the ones who keep Free Speech TV alive. Free Speech TV does not take corporate money, and that's why your financial support is so important to us. It's your voice as a viewer and not corporate shareholders that fuel Free Speech TV and drive our programming decisions. You can help protect free speech today with your donation. Your donation is going to help keep voices like Tom Hartman, Stephanie Miller, Bill Press, Amy Goodman, David Pakman, and us here at Ring of Fire. Your donation is going to help keep us all on the air. Together, we have some of the best educated and most informed viewers out there, and your contributions to Free Speech TV help to keep these voices going throughout this election. Everyone should have access to news and information that's forming the world around them, and our goal is to keep you and everyone involved. We aim to reach every viewer possible because we're all in this together. And Free Speech has a lot of plans for expansion and outreach this year, but we can't fulfill those dreams without your help. So go online to freespeech.org and help support independent, honest news journalism. Your support will help to keep information flowing, and together we can hold the corporate media accountable. Not only is your donation tax deductible, but we do also offer a few things in return. With a donation of $60, you'll receive a Free Speech TV Stamp Stampede collaboration t-shirt. With a donation of $120, you'll receive two Ring of Fire mugs and the Corporations Are Not People stamp. And with a pledge of $240, you'll get the Free Speech TV Stamp Stampede collaboration t-shirt, Jane Mayer's new book, Dark Money, The Hidden History of Billionaires Behind the Radical Right, and the Corporations Are Not People stamp. Now, this is our first pledge drive of 2016, so let's make sure that we get off to a great start. The voices here on Free Speech TV are going to be so important during this election of 2016, and your donation today is going to help make sure that these voices continue to be heard. We appreciate your support. And speaking of fighting back against corporate rule, Congresswoman Debbie Wasserman Schultz has been an absolute disaster as the head of the Democratic Party. whether it's been rigging the debate schedule to help a certain candidate or siding with Republicans on destroying consumer protections, Wasserman Schultz has proven that she cannot be trusted to lead the party in the right direction. And that's why Tim Canova is challenging her for her House seat this year, and Ring of Fire Radio's Sam Cedar recently spoke with Tim about his campaign. Let's take a look.
So, Tim, let's just start from the beginning. You know, I rarely end up speaking to people who are running for Congress, and particularly people who are primarying or involved in primaries, just because there's so many across the country. But you are running against a Democratic incumbent whose re-election would have, or lack of re-election, I should say, would have a lot of national significance, particularly to progressives across the country. You are running in Florida's 23rd congressional district that is based around Hollywood, Florida. And the incumbent is Debbie Wasserman Schultz, who also happens to be head of the DNC. And so let's start. I want to circle back to the district and some of the local issues and some of the broader issues you want to talk about. But recently you sent a letter, an open letter, to Debbie Wasserman Schultz about payday lenders. Tell us about that.
Well, it's been reported that Debbie Wasserman Schultz is pushing legislation in the House of Representatives, which would help the payday lending industry, and it would help preempt state consumer protection laws that seek to protect consumers from the payday lending industry. And at the same time, Wasserman Schultz has been taking many thousands of dollars from this industry over the past decade. So it's a pattern with her of taking an awful lot of corporate money in aggregate in the many millions of dollars and voting along their lines on specific votes, pushing their policy positions constantly.
And I mean, this is, and I imagine, I mean, that this is one of the big reasons why you're running against her. I want to talk about some of the other things that she's opposed, particularly other initiatives by the Consumer Financial Protection Bureau. This, of course, is the bureau that Elizabeth Warren basically birthed in many respects and was the head of, at least the acting head for some time in its first couple of years. But give us a sense of of Florida's 23rd congressional district, because I want to get a sense as to whether or not, just even on a local level, I mean, and we can talk more about why our national audience might have interest in you winning this race. But from a local perspective, tell us about the 23rd congressional district and how Debbie Wasserman Schultz may be a little bit out of step with what the district wants.
Well, I think she's a lot of bit out of step right now. The 23rd straddles two counties. It's the southern part of Broward County, and it is the northern part of Miami-Dade County. It's actually probably, from what I've been hearing from all sources, perhaps the most liberal county in the state of, the most liberal congressional district in the state of Florida. And she has been out of step on a number of issues, and we could talk about the regulation of Wall Street or the deregulation of Wall Street banks, which she continues to pursue. She's a drug warrior, and her constituents are really not on that page at all. And Wasserman Schultz was dead set against medical marijuana. She has been taking money from private prisons. She supports private prisons. This is that whole mass incarceration model. And, you know, you can go right down the list. It's a bit shocking in this day and age to be preventing the Consumer Financial Protection Bureau from regulating racial discrimination in car loans. It's pretty shocking, as we said, to be preventing the Consumer Financial Protection Bureau from regulating payday loans. She has also voted to permit big Wall Street banks to use depositor money risky derivative investments. So there's issue after issue where she's out of step, and you wonder what explains it. Does she just have this ideology that's different? I think it's the system that has changed her politics. From what I understand, when she first went into politics, she was a more progressive representative. But after a decade of taking millions of dollars, the system changes people. When you take money in such large quantities, you're going to be listening to those voices, those interests that have been giving you the money. And I think, like a lot of incumbents, she's taken her own constituents for granted. You take a look at the congressional map, and 90% of the districts in this country are pretty safe districts. They're either Democratic or Republican, right? Because of gerrymandering. And this district, Florida's 23rd, has been pretty safely Democratic up until now. So if there's no primary challenge, and there usually is not a primary challenge, and Debbie Wasserman Schultz has never had a primary challenge, then you don't have to really be so accountable to your constituents. You could take thousands of dollars from pharmaceutical companies, from private prisons, from political action committees representing alcohol companies, and you could remain a drug warrior. And she did this for a long time, just expecting a free pass. After all, she's Debbie Wasserman Schultz. She's the head of the DNC. She expects a free pass that she should just get reelected. And, you know, this primary challenge is significant in that it doesn't happen often enough. If we succeed, it will create a blueprint, I think, for lots of other progressives to challenge their party's candidates. Their party's incumbents, when those incumbents have become too cozy with corporate interests. And the benefit of this, I think, when looking at it in a larger level, is that all too often, I hear this from Democrats all the time, and I've heard it for years, that we're often left in November with a choice of voting for the lesser of two evils. How many times do you hear, oh, I held my nose to vote for this, you know, Democrat, but God forbid that Republican gets in, we wouldn't want that right to happen. So it's the lesser evil politics. Well, the grassroots, the progressives in our party have been getting galvanized. You see it happening at the national level with the Bernie Sanders campaign. I see it happening here in our district. And if progressives can be organized and put up very credible challengers who have the interests of working families first and foremost, way ahead of the interests of corporations, that leads to the kind of politics where we don't have to vote in November for the lesser of two evils.
Right. Well, I'll tell you, Tim, we got to take a break in a minute here, but the interesting thing to me about your race, and we have already seen this sort of precedent on the Republican side, where David Bratt primaried Eric Cantor and ultimately took his seat in Congress, and this is the guy who was number two, who was in line to be Speaker of the House of Congress. And I know there are a lot of progressives out there. I know there's a lot of frustration with not just the Democratic Party, but specifically the DNC. And there's a lot of people out there who are looking to send a message to the Democratic establishment saying you cannot take the Democratic base, you cannot take the Democratic left, the Democratic progressive, however you want to describe them, you can't take them for advantage. So I would not be surprised, frankly, to see you get a lot more attention nationally from those progressives who want to send a message to the Democratic Party, you know, which is not to say that your policies, and we're gonna take a break, and we're gonna talk more specifically about what your thoughts about the Fed and about some of those issues that you intend to champion. But just to send a message, I would imagine you're gonna get a lot of attention from progressives across the country. We got to take a quick break. We're gonna come back with Tim Canova. He is running. He is primarying Debbie Wasserman Schultz, the who also happens to be the chair of the DNC, but she is a Congresswoman from Florida's 23rd Congressional District. We'll be right back with Tim Canova.
In 1980, 52 separate corporations owned the media, ranging from newspapers to magazines to television. TV media was considered a marketplace for important ideas and investigative stories. America had one of the most vibrant media infrastructures in the world. Today, five multi-conglomerate corporations own all of it. They own all the media, TV, radio, newspaper, and magazines.
The truth is, meaningful reporting has died. It's created a window, a void that can be occupied by outlets like Free Speech TV, where advertisers and powerful politicos and NBAs don't tell us what we can or cannot say. They don't tell us what we can or can't report. Corporate media is dead, ladies and gentlemen. But truth teller outlets like Free Speech TV, well, they're just now being born. So here's the problem. If you want reporting that's not controlled by a corporate-owned and dominated CEO, if you believe that you deserve a sincere reporting outlet that has no allegiance, no political party affiliation, if you understand that our democracy required diversity and truthfulness and courage and commitment and telling the whole truth about wars or the economy or corporate corruption or our environment, if you believe that and you understand that, then you understand that you have to be in control of that message. That's what we do at Free Speech TV. Not the Beltway, not Wall Street, not Madison Avenue. You are in control by empowering Free Speech TV, by giving us the financial support, the tools to do what we promise to do for you every day, right here on Ring of Fire, 5 days a week. My pledge to you is that not a dollar is going to be wasted. Every dollar you pledge to Free Speech TV is going to be honored as your commitment to change. News reporting is going to change right here, right now. The truth is, we're a family here at Free Speech TV who cares for, believes in, and advocates for what you believe in every day. I'm asking for your financial support to allow us to do our job the way you deserve. Go online to freespeech.org to help keep honest, independent media on the air. In the truest sense, Free Speech TV has the potential to be our line in the sand, a statement that TV reporting does have the capacity to create the kind of outrage that puts Wall Street white-collar criminals in prison. Your voice delivered through free speech programming really does have the potential outrage that demands that we save our planet from fossil fuel outlaws who are going to drill and frack until our grandchildren exist around an irreversible environment catastrophe. When you turn on Free Speech TV, you're going to hear our outrage. Your demands are going to be articulated by some of the most important voices in progressive media. Tom Hartman, Amy Goodman, real journalists who have devoted their lives to being your voice for your cause. Your voice only stays alive if you believe that what you think every day, what you believe every day, what you're committed to every day can show up on a network like Free Speech TV. Your voice delivered on a sustainable TV outlet unlike any other network. Think about it. Your voice kept us out of a war in Syria. Your voice saved the internet from corporate control. It was your voice, your outrage, that forced Obama time after time to do what he was unwilling to do. Free Speech TV is your voice. Believe that your voice, your beliefs are important enough to be heard. I promise I will speak your voice. To do that, I'm going to need your help. Go to freespeech.org and help preserve your voice in the national media.
So, Tim, when we took our break, you were telling us about some of the things that I think, you know, describe Debbie Wasserman Schultz as out of sync with Florida's 23rd congressional district, including Hollywood, Florida, which you've described as perhaps the most liberal congressional district in Florida. And I have to say that just nationally speaking, I mean, Debbie Wasserman Schultz, and tell me if I've got my facts wrong here, she voted for fast track against most of the Democrats in the House, as far as I can tell.
She was actually the only Democrat in the Florida congressional delegation, in the House delegation, to vote for fast tracking the Trans-Pacific Partnership.
She voted against the Consumer Financial Protection Bureau having the ability to regulate auto lending, or at least some parts of it. She, like you said, she voted against, she came out against the medical marijuana bill in Florida. She voted against giving the SEC and the IRS the ability to require the disclosing of corporate spending in politics. I mean, this is pretty stunning stuff. I don't even know if I would expect like a Democratic Congress person from, I don't know, from Wyoming to vote this way, frankly. It's pretty shocking that she's doing so in this type of district. But give us a sense, I mean, aside from those issues, and like you say, she's introduced legislation attacking the Consumer Financial Protection Bureau's ability to regulate payday lending, which I just find shocking. I mean, I just find it shocking from a political standpoint. She must really feel like she's completely untouchable and could do whatever she wants, or I guess whatever her corporate donors want her to do. But I want to move off that for a moment and talk about monetary policy, because you have... You, of course, are a law professor, and you have spent a lot of time studying these issues. Give me your sense of what we need to see in terms of monetary policy in this country.
Well, it's interesting. You look at the debate about monetary policy now, and it's whether the Federal Reserve should raise interest rates another quarter point, keep raising rates a little bit. Is the economy heating up too much? Should the Fed slow down the economy by raising rates a little bit? And it's sort of the kind of debate we had in the 1990s. It doesn't really reflect what's happened. When you take a look at what has happened to our economy with the 2008 financial crisis, you know, we hit what's been called the Great Recession. It's left millions of people behind. This recovery has left millions of people behind. Now, I see it since I teach at a law school and I've been at teaching at universities for the last 20 years, my students at other schools, this generation, this millennial generation, has it real tough. The economy is really stuck in the mud. It's not been a growth economy for the labor markets at all. And most of the income generated in the past 8 years has gone to the very top 1%. So what can policymakers do about it? Certainly, we need different kind of fiscal policies. We need to have really a New Deal kind of a fiscal approach where the government is rebuilding infrastructure, having better trade agreements, encouraging manufacturing, helping folks with public sector jobs, but also with higher education. That's all sort of on the table. You hear that a lot in this campaign from both Democratic candidates for president. But the Federal Reserve also could be doing more to help the mainstream economy, as it did in the 1930s and 1940s. Back then, the regional Federal Reserve banks actually made loans directly to small businesses, and in large amounts. They weren't tiny amounts. It was hundreds of millions of dollars. We've seen just in the past few years conservative Stanford law professors calling on the Fed to purchase municipal bonds. The way it's helped the mortgage-backed security market, it could help state and local governments by driving down the interest rate on municipal bonds so that state and local governments could make the kinds of infrastructure investments they need and help put people back to work. And I say the same thing as far as student debtors. I see my students who are paying 6 or 7% interest on their loans for a lousy economy. You know, that means if it's a 7% interest rate, they're going to pay back as much in interest over the course of a decade as they're paying in principal. So, sure, we can talk about whether the Fed should raise interest rates a quarter of a percentage point on the treasury market or for big banks. But really what they need to be doing is driving down rates and making lending more affordable for Main Street interests.
Now, I know that in addition to your notion that we should have a people's Fed, as sometimes we hear it referred to. I mean, give me your sense on trade, because there's a lot of people who think that the TPP and the TTIP, which is basically its cousin deal with the European Union, is going to come up for a vote, very possibly in the lame duck session, or perhaps after the next Congress is sworn in. But give us your sense on trade, whether or not you're going to be a vote for the TPP or against it. But then I also want to hear about what you think is the primary issue that is going to take you over the top in this campaign against Debbie Wasserman Schultz.
Sure. Well, I have been very opposed to the TPP, and I will remain opposed to the TPP. Not only will it allow the outsourcing of tens of thousands of more jobs from Florida and millions from around the United States to countries that have no respect for labor standards or human rights, it will also undermine our national sovereignty, our constitutional framework. And it'll do so by essentially allowing big foreign investors, big multinational corporations to challenge federal, state, and local laws that are intended to protect the public health and safety, the environment, food labeling, you name it. They can all be challenged under the TPP as infringing upon the profit opportunities of these foreign investors, requiring compensation. And the suits are not heard by U.S. courts. They're heard by arbitration panels made up mostly of corporate lawyers. And we see that this is exactly what happened recently when TransCanada announced it was going to sue the U.S. government for $15 billion under the NAFTA dispute settlement provisions, very similar to the TPPs, in response to President Obama's decision not to move forward with the XL Keystone pipeline. So the TPP would make everything more difficult in protecting the public health and safety, in regulating greenhouse gases to try to deal with the climate change problem. I am hammering away at the climate change issue here, because here in South Florida, we're looking at a true crisis, not some distant type of theoretical crisis. They say that within just a few years, big parts of South Florida will be underwater. We already see when there's not a cloud in the sky, when it just happens to be high tide, streets in Miami and Hollywood, all along the coast, and even inland here, are flooded. And, you know, you've got this energy industry that wants to be fracking in the Everglades. And my opponent has been really mealy-mouthed about fracking. And I'm not. I'm very opposed to fracking. I think we should convert as soon as possible to an alternative, sustainable energy economy. And that means, look, we're in the Sunshine State. We should be moving forward with solar energy in a big way. We see foreign countries like Germany that are way ahead of us in solar and wind. And we need a new electric grid. So we need a lot of investments to modernize the economy, to make it an economy that is safe and productive for future generations. The Fed and, you know, monetary and fiscal policy is one part of it, but certainly we shouldn't be hampering ourselves with bad trade agreements that allow foreign investors to shift the cost of compliance from the big corporations to taxpayers. You know, I look at some of the other issues. You ask what will put me over the top. Income and wealth inequality is a major one. We have a big policy statement up on our website on this now. Millennials, baby boomers, Gen Xers, you name it, they're all feeling this badly. This income inequality is hurting them quite a bit, hurting all of us. I'd say, however, the one key issue that ties all of this together really is the corruption in the political system and the need for campaign finance reform. You know, my opponent, you look at what she's done just since we've jumped into this race. Her DNC overruled President Obama's 2008 ban on corporate lobbyist contributions to the Democratic National Committee. I'm in favor of banning corporate donations to the DNC. We have to take this dark money out of our politics. We have to move towards publicly financed elections that maximize small donor contributions. We should have free airtime. You know, this for candidates so that they can communicate with the voters. The United States is one of only something like half a dozen democracies in the world right now that doesn't even have publicly financed elections for their federal office holders.
Well, Tim Canova, the website is timcanova.com. Folks, I imagine, are going to want to visit there, and that's where they can go to support your primary challenge of Debbie Wasserman Schultz. Thanks so much for your time today, Tim.
Sam, thank you. Very much appreciate it.
And that's all the time we have for today, but you can get more news at our website, theringoffire.com. You can get our daily podcast by going online to rofpodcast.com, and you can subscribe to our YouTube channel at youtube.com/goleftv. I'm Farron Cousins, and we'll see you next week.